being an only child, one of the things that happened is I get to pick my brothers and sisters. And I must say, God has been quite generous with the selection of brothers and sisters He's bought my way. And He's helped me to realize something very important. There is no such thing as an only child in the kingdom of God, which is a good thing. And what I've discovered about this family, this spiritual family, this family that is given to me because God is my Father and Jesus Christ is my elder brother, is we come in all shapes, sizes, colors, genders. We are varied in personalities. Some of us are introverts, some of us are just extroverts, some of us are good singers, some of us have voices that rest in a very large choir, some of us write, some of us read wonderfully, some of us can paint. We're just in this massive, wonderful thing that God has created called the family of God. There is such variety. So we all don't look alike. We don't like the same things. I know that there are some of us among us today that think spinach is the best vegetable on the planet. Trust me. Personally, you can have my portion. I know that there are some of us that have voices that really should be recorded. And some of us, we hide behind other people's voices. Because, well, we will make a joyful noise. But we are family. What is a family? While we consider this thing of family relations. I also know that there are some families where the kids like each other and the kids don't like each other. I'm sorry to say that that has happened within our own Christian family. Now, no one would ever outright say that I don't like you, because, well, that wouldn't be Christ-like, but the clothes you wear, no, no, no. Or how you sing, oh, no, 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 no. Or, well, we can come up with all sorts of different reasons to break that connection in our family. And we have. But I want to talk about the most important connection we have. Because you see, whether we go by denomination, Baptist, Protestant, Methodist, Episcopal, Anglican, kind of the whole, it does not matter. What does matter is these two things. God has created us and called us good. And we are not only children. The other important thing that matters to us is this. We are connected. We are connected because of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Just by confessing Him as Lord and Savior, we are connected. And in 1 Corinthians 12, Paul talked about the fact that we can't disconnect ourselves. But I want to talk about the most important connection of all. I want to talk about our connection to God, our Creator. Which is probably a good idea, because if it wasn't for Him, we wouldn't be here. I want to talk to us about our connection and our relationship with Him. You see, over the years, there have been some conversations about what this relationship is supposed to be like. And there are some people that think that In order to be connected with God, you must see Him as this
great, mighty Savior, aloof and cold and uninterested in His creation.
And then there's the other extreme that are so familiar with God that they just call Him, "Hey, what's up?" Not giving Him the reverence and the honor that He deserves. I think a healthy relationship is somewhere in between, where we don't push Him away, but we aren't so familiar with Him that we forget. If He didn't get us up this morning, we wouldn't be here. If He hadn't put the world on automatic reset, we'd be in trouble. There needs to be a healthy balance. Because when God was thinking about this relationship stuff, you know what? The first thing He did was He fixed something that is so beautiful. Look out your windows. The sky, the trees, the plants. Look at the person sitting next to you or across the way from you. Unique, beautiful, because God said so. And God did some pretty good, I'd say God did some of His best work in pulling together these things called humans, you and me. I'd say he did his best work. And He knew we were going to be amazing creatures. He understood that we were going to be gardeners and artists and musicians. And then, while He was making us, God did this really strange thing. I imagine it this way. God the Father, God the Son, sitting in eternity and said, I'm going to make some humans. I imagine the angels going, "What? What are those?" And God saying, "My best work." God saying, "Keep whole." And just crafting us. You see, the Word of God says we are fearfully and wonderfully made. So, my question is this. If God has spent so much time and so much effort and so much care in making these interesting things called humans, who are we to mistreat each other? What does that do to our relationship with our Creator? If we can think of ways to be unkind to each other. And it doesn't matter whether we use a gun, a knife, a missile, our lips, our tongue, our thoughts about one another. If God says keep whole, why are we saying otherwise? Now I have to admit, some of my fellow preachers do make me wonder sometimes. I mean, really? What were you thinking with? Has been some of my conversations with the television and CNN from time to time. However, they are still God's creation, and God said, keep hope. And I think God realized and understood that we humans were going to do something stupid from the very beginning. We were going to do something stupid. Now, for those those decades and centuries where the women have been blamed for the original fall, I just have one thing to say. Adam 8:2. Both of us, male and female, hold responsibility for the fall of humanity. Okay, that's it. That's all I'm going to say. But it took one man to rectify all of that. And you see, God kept trying to build this relationship with us human beings, and they're called the covenants. And He's the one who started them, and He said, this is what I'm going to do. I'm going to show you how cool I am and how much I want to love you. I'm going to bless you sitting down. I'm going to bless you standing up. I'm going to bless you when you walk. I'm going to bless you when you sit still. I'm going to bless you when you cry. I'm going to bless you when you laugh. I'm going to bless you. You are not going to want for anything. All I ask is just an occasional thank you from time to time, Although the Apostle Paul says, do not cease to thank him. And if you really think about it, we got enough to tell him thank you for. I'm just wondering. I just hope I don't ever run out of thank yous, God. Because day after day, morning after morning, week after week, year after year, for the last years, I have had reasons to say thank you, God. When I have not been the most angelic of beings, following all of the rule God rules, He still loved me. When I did the stupid thing that my parent told me not to do, because I was, well, I was 13, 14, 15, and I knew better than my parents. And He still loved me. And we all have those moments in our lives where, if we look back, we did something stupid. Now, the world would like to make you believe that if you do something stupid or something dangerous or something dumb, that God is finished with you. They are mistaken. There is absolutely nothing you could do that will make God stop loving you. That's how committed He is to the relationship He builds between us. Nothing can separate us from the love of God. And just because the attempts and the efforts to get us to understand that God does love us and how we can live in relationship with Him didn't always work, here's what He did. He looked at the sun and He said, I need someone to go down and talk for us and tell our beautiful creation that I'm not mad at them, that they still matter to me. And son, you know, we've been talking about this since the beginning of time, and when the appointed time came, imagine this, the sun, God Himself, the one who was there when the stars were created, the one who was there that watched the Father create and craft these human beings and make the world and make the galaxies and all of His splendor and all of His glory, and the angels had enough sense to say glory to God in the highest. This God stuffed Himself, all that glory, in the body of a child, in an embryo, and placed Himself in a mother's womb so know and understand what it is like to be human. In case you haven't noticed, being human can be a bit of a adventure. And yet, God so loved us that he stepped out of heaven, compacted his glory into an embryo, and was born as we are born, and lived among us, experiencing poopy diapers, and experiencing fears and hunger and doubt and all of the things that make us human, and fixing it so that we would never have to be alienated from God again. That the relationship that had been broken in the Garden of Eden could be repaired and made stronger because he became the link between us and all of the stuff that was separating us, our stubbornness, our pride, our arrogance, our knowing, you know, sometimes we act like a bunch of know-it-alls, all of that stuff would never, ever separate us from God again, because standing in the gap would be Christ Jesus. So let's just get some understanding here. God has every intention of there being a relationship between us and him. That's his prime directive. That's what he intended from the very start. And irregardless to who did what or who didn't do what, he still has not changed his mind. We are important to him. Now, we live in a world that will tell us that we don't matter. And they'll find a reason. Anything from our skin color to our gender to where we live to how much money we have in the bank, if we have a bank account. There are going to be people that are going to try and find a way to separate us and separate us from God. But here's the thing. They can't do it. They aren't God. And God has made up his mind. I made you. I'm keeping you. You're mine, and I love you. And there's nothing you can do about it. It's not easy living in a fallen world, especially when you are trying to live according to the principles of being a disciple of Jesus Christ. It's not easy, I'll give you that. But his grace is always sufficient for us. There are many things that try to separate us. Our obligations to family, our obligations to our professions. But here's the thing. Nothing is going to separate us. Not even when we forget or we say, or it gets whispered in our ears, you don't matter anymore. That's a lie. You will always matter. So my encouragement this morning is that we take very good care of this relationship that cost an innocent man his life. I would invite us to take extra special care of that relationship, because we live in a world that is not necessarily going to value it. And when you know that you are a child of God, you can walk anywhere, anytime, do whatever you have to do, and nobody can take it from you. And you are still going to shine, because you have Christ living within you and Christ shining through you. By the way, can you imagine this? This is the other thing that God did that tells you how much confidence he has in us as human beings. You see, not everybody knows what we know. We know that God is good. We know that God loves us. We know that his son came to tell us that and to show it to us. priest. We know that. But does the entire world know it? Have the entire world received the message? No. Because if they received the message and taken it into their heart, we wouldn't have any of the crazy we got going on now. Now here's the thing that God did that just blows my mind. That's the message. And he chose us as the messengers. Yeah. These flawed, imperfect, don't always get it right. Sometimes hard-headed human beings, we are the vessels to deliver the message to the world that there is a Savior, that Christ has died, Christ has risen, and Christ will come again. We are the examples in our jobs and in our homes of what it means to be a disciple of Jesus Christ. And he trusts us with that job. Humans? Women. I can imagine the angels saying, women, God, you're going to give the job of telling people about you to the ones that you just made? And God says yes. And they're going to be fine. And I can imagine the angels are going, if you say so. You see, we got entrusted with something, the most precious thing in the world, in the universe. We got entrusted with the message that Jesus Christ is our Lord, can be Lord and Savior, and we can walk a life that allows us to get through just about everything. And we are assured that when we do get through this, and we will get through it, we will be with him, and we will be like him, and all our striving, we will be like him, and we will look like our Heavenly Father, glorious and wonderful and marvelous and full of grace and full of peace and hope and joy and peace. And we will finally look like our Heavenly Father. So my encouragement to you, brothers and sisters in Christ, oh, by the way, God, thanks for the large spiritual family. With all our quirks, with all our challenges. Thanks for my big, great, big, wonderful family. I invite you, beloved brothers and sisters in Christ, first of all, strengthen your relationship with your Heavenly Father through the loving Son and the gift of the Holy Spirit who teaches us every day, who walks with us, who lives within us. I invite you to give that relationship your highest priority, because it is how we give the message. God is with us. God comforts us. God provides for us. God heals us. God is Father. And he's a good one. Now there would be some theologians if they walked in the door and heard me saying, calling him Father, that would be absolutely appalled, because it's such a patriarchal a designation. Well, the one who got me through, the one who guides us, the one who comforts us,
the one who cares for us. I don't have a problem with him being God the Father. He's been a good one. I got no complaints. And if he has been as good to you as he has been to me, I do not mind calling him Abba. What I invite you, beloved sisters and brothers, keep that relationship as your prime directive, your top priority. Keep that relationship the reason you get up in the morning and thank him when you get in bed, get in your bed at night. That is how we get from day to day, moment to moment, and time to time. And that's how we get through the disappointments and the heartaches, is that wonderful relationship with Abba, our wonderful counselor, our mighty God, our Prince of Peace, our healer, our comforter, our protector, our savior, our God, our help, our advocate. As the saints in the church I grew up in saying, he's a lawyer in the courtroom and a doctor in the operating room. I'm the operating chair. He's your banker, because he supplies all of our needs. We do need him. So make that relationship your top priority. And when other things try to pull you away from it, you say, back off. This is family business. My father, my brother, my elder brother, and the blessed Holy Spirit come first. Amen. Invite and ask God for a closer relationship, the closest one we've ever had, and more. And we grow and we glow in our relationship with Christ Jesus. Hymn number 528, Nearer My God.